the King of Glory enter.
Peace to your home, and peace to all that you have. This morning our topic is still on faith versus fear. And I'm going to show you, when you have faith, what God can do with a little bit of faith. Because some things that will be an emergency for some people cannot become a priority. That is why we need God to show us the difference. The Bible says, seek first the kingdom of God and its righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto us. Because my role in the kingdom consists of multiple roles. I'm realizing that I need God more and more to show me what's important. What's important in one season may not need the same priority in the next season. What is God's priority for us in our lives? We're going to go to Mark's Gospel. We're going to study briefly a story that he thought that was important to include to give us a full picture of Jesus as we're coming to know him. It's been shocking to us some of the priorities that Jesus did and how much different those priorities are than maybe what we would have expected. We see him stopping to heal a woman that was bent backwards. She was bent so badly over, and we see he's on his way to heal a little girl, someone that was important, and yet he stops to heal a woman that was not important. The important girl that he was on his way to heal, her father's name was Jairus. He was a synagogue leader. The woman who came up behind Jesus didn't even know, he didn't even give a name. Nobody really cared about the woman that was bent over. He stops en route with a miracle. And the more important girl dies. In fact, while he stops to heal this unimportant woman, the important girl dies. Jesus isn't concerned about this because he is a healer. Yes, he's the resurrection and the life. His priority at this moment is to show the people a deeper revelation of who he is. The only way for him to give them his revelation of the power of his presence is to upset their priorities and stop for something that they see is less important. So that when he gets to the scene which was more important, the little girl is already dead. This provides an opportunity for him to do something that he could not have done if she was alive. If he had gone according to their priorities, sometimes God will upset your priorities to show you his power in a whole new way. And I know it's hard to give God praise for that, but God has been doing some unusual things in our lives lately. And it seems difficult to get Jesus to follow your agenda. Maybe he's reordering your priorities. Maybe what was important to you then shouldn't be important to you now. And he's trying to show you an order of importance and of faith. That's how you can know when the presence of God is really increasing in your day-to-day life. It will shift your priorities. Goosebumps don't prove the presence of God. What proves the presence of God in our lives is when our priorities begin to align with his word. And this is going to require a collision because cultural priorities are very different. Mark chapter 5, a story that Mark thought was very important enough to include for us. Imagine you have to write a gospel account and you have to decide what's the most important teaching Jesus gave that you want to put in Mark. What stories are you going to leave out? Because it's not like you could say, well, that wasn't any good or that's not important. When he healed a blind man and he opened deaf ears, there was no way you could pick and choose which one you're going to include. Like things that Jesus did on his way to appointments would would have been our greatest accomplishments in our lives. Look at the woman that was bent over. Nobody thought it was important. They didn't even give a name. But Jesus thought it was very important to heal her first before going to the girl that died. And now Mark is to decide, all right, what are the most important stories? And so in order to do that, he has to choose one theme and he has to get this theme across. I want you to show you. Mark decides he's going to show Jesus' authority. And his authority is not illustrated, but it's explained. And this is a demonstration of Jesus' authority that I don't think you'll soon forget. Let me read it to you so that you will understand it. Mark chapter 5 verses 1. Then they came to the other side of the sea, to the country of the Gadarenes. And when he had come out of the boat, immediately they met him out of the tombs, a man with an unclean spirit, who had his dwelling among the tombs, and no one could bind him, not even with chains, because he had often been bound with shackles and chains, and the chains had been pulled apart by him, and the shackles broken in pieces. Neither could anyone tame him. No one was strong enough to subdue him. And this is where we need a miracle working Jesus. We can't have a sweetie-pie Jesus. We can't have a sweetheart Jesus. But you might come to a point in your life where you've lost sight of who you are and whose you are. And in those moments, you don't want a little puny Jesus who stands over on the side and waits until you rub your hands together and pull him out of the bottle on Christmas Day and Easter Sunday, or when you decide to bless him with your presence coming to church. No, no, no. In those moments, you're going to want a strong Savior with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm. I'm talking about an awesome Jesus. Verses 5 says, and always, night and day, he was in the mountains and in the tombs, crying out and cutting himself with stones. Verses 6 is interesting. It was his first time to see Jesus, but it wasn't Jesus' first vision of him. When he saw Jesus from afar, Jesus did his ministry in Capernaum. This account is from a Gentile region, the region of the Gerasenes. Jesus would go up in the mountains praying early in the morning and late at night. And across the Sea of Galilee, where Jesus had just traveled, the sound would have traveled. So if this man is crying out day and night, there's a good chance Jesus would have been up early in the morning while the man was crying. Jesus was praying. And maybe one morning after hearing the man cry one more time, Jesus decided, today is the day to make my way towards this man and set him free. If you are that person today and you need a miracle from Jesus, he'll never pass you by. He hears that cry. Could it be that God has heard your cry and he has heard the secret petitions and disappointments of your heart? And he had you log on today, because today is the day that he came to see you. When you thought no one else was listening and you thought you were all alone, could it be that he heard you and now the man sees Jesus? Possibly before Jesus even lays eyes on the man, and he ran and fell on his knees in front of him. Oh, by the way, your first response to God will often be fear. Verses 7, he shouted at the top of his voice, what do you want with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? In God's name, don't torture me. When God shows up in your life, a real power, in real power, there will be something in you that will resist that authority. Because it goes against anything that is ingrained in our humanity to be in the presence of the one who is greater than us. And it often causes us to re-evaluate our priorities. Now, in this man's case, there is a specific reason that he falls on his knees and shouts, "What do you want with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? In God's name, don't torture me." This is a madman crying out to Jesus. This is Jesus' response. Jesus said to him, "Come out of this man, you impure spirit." And Jesus challenged the spirit that was within the man, and the spirit within the man resisted the challenge of Jesus. Because any time the enemy has occupied a territory for a while, he won't let it go without a fight. Jesus asked him a question, not for information, but for revelation. And Jesus asked the man, "What is your name?" And the man responded, "My name is Legion, for we are many." And he begged Jesus again and again not to send him out of the area. The demons begged Jesus, "Don't make us leave." And this is where the story gets interesting. Verse 11. And I promise you, the Bible is way more bizarre than you give it credit for. Verse 11, a large herd of pigs. We know we're not in Jewish territory anymore, because there would not be a large herd of pigs there. Jesus has left his home turf and is crossed over. And now he's in Gentile territory, the region of the Gadarenes. And there's a large herd of pigs standing nearby on the hillside feeding. And the demons beg Jesus, "Send us to the pigs. Allow us to go into them." He gave them permission. "Okay, leave the man and you can jump on the pigs." And the impure spirits came out and went into the pigs. And the herd about 2,000, remember the legion is 600. The herd, which was 2,000 in number, rushed down the steep bank into the lake and were drowned. Can I say something? There is a connection between you and these pigs. And if you give me a few minutes and pay close attention, I'll show you what it is. Verse 14, those tending the pigs ran off and reported this in the town and countryside. And the people went to see what had happened. When they came to Jesus, they saw the man who had been possessed by the legion of demons sitting there, dressed in his right mind, and they were afraid. Those who had seen it told the people what had happened to the demon-possessed man and told about the pigs as well. And then the people began to plead with Jesus to leave their region. I want to say, look how important you must be that Jesus would go through all this trouble to keep an appointment with you. Now we're going to go, that was the Mark chapter 5. I'm going to go back to Mark chapter 4. I'm going to show you a series of events that happened before Mark chapter 5. Let's go to Mark chapter 4 verses 35 to 41. I want to tell you about the storm that came before the miracle. I'll show you what happens before you come into a miracle, how Satan will put stumbling blocks in your way. This passage of scripture will preach all by itself, because watch, this is how many of you are going through a storm in your life today, or somebody close to you is going through a storm. See how easy it is to preach about storms. Maybe some of you just came out of a storm, or you know there's probably a storm around the corner. Say to yourself, there's a storm out on the ocean. So let me read this to you so that your faith can rise. That day when evening came, this is the same day now, remember, where Jesus rebuked or got the demons out of this demonic man. That day when evening came, this is the same day, remember, I'm talking about the same day. Mark didn't divide this into chapters. We did that later when they wrote the Bible. Mark's writing all this in one story. That day when evening came, Jesus said to his disciple, "Let's go over to the other side." He doesn't tell them why. He doesn't say, "Because I've got an appointment on the other side." He just tells them what God is saying. When you don't know why, trust God, He will show you the reason. Can you just go, get in and go, even though you don't know where you are going? When Jesus says, get into the boat, will you do it? If you believe He has all authority, you don't need full details to be obedient. This is just for the obedient ones who are willing to cross over. Now make a note of this. You can cross over without conflict. Jesus is moving the mission forward. He's leaving the comfort zone of Capernaum, meaning comfort. He's leaving the comfort zone and is moving into enemy territory. Like some of you are doing right now in your life. You are beginning to move forward in the things of God. You're changing your circle. You're changing your values. You have begun to prioritize the presence of God. But let me warn you, when you make God your priority, the enemy will send a storm. You never cross over without conflict. Did you expect the devil would let you go without a fight? Did you expect that he would let you leave Egypt without sending his chariots to chase you down? You've been serving the devil for many years, some of you, and now you decided to stand up and be a godly man or woman, and you think it's just going to change overnight? As a matter of fact, I want to announce to you, the reason the storm is raging might not be because you're Jonah heading away from the will of God. It might be because you're crossing over into the calling that God is on your side, or God has on your life. That's what the conflict is all about. Sometimes when you're in a storm, you need somebody to shout at you and say, "Hey, you're gonna make it through this." How do you know? Because Jesus said, "We're going onto the other side." So you can't die in your storm. You're going to make it through to the other side. That's what I want to share with you. I preached so many sermons about a storm, and I've told so many people that they can survive what they're going through. But there's a more important question that I want to ask you. Will you survive the storm? The better question is to ask is, why did you survive the storm? Have you thought about how many things the enemy did, even early in your life, to try to stop you from having a relationship with God? Remember, this is Mark chapter 4, not Mark chapter 5. This man is not even seeing Jesus yet. Yet there is a storm that is set up on the Sea of Galilee to keep Jesus from getting to him. I know you're thinking, how do you know the devil started the storm? Maybe it was just climate change. But I'm going to show you from scripture. Because the Bible says, Jesus rebuked the wind and the waves. Jesus doesn't rebuke natural elements. He rebukes demons. The same demonic oppression that was oppressing that man was in that sea trying to stop Jesus from getting to the man. You were on the devil's hit list before you were ever born. There were things in your family line that were happening before you were born that were designed to keep you from listening to this word this moment. In spite of all the storms that had your name on them, in spite of all the winds and the waves and the hurricane forces, in spite of every attack, look, you're listening online. Look, you're getting involved. Look, you're taking notes. Look, you're praising God. Look, you're believing for a brighter day. Look how you made it. You must be important. Your faith sustained you. You survived. You know how I know you're important? I know it because of the car. I know it not because of the car you drive, not because of the house you live in, not because I looked up how many Instagram followers you have. I know you're important because of your storm. See, the size of your storm tells me something about your faith in God. The size of your storm lets me know the importance of your assignment. The devil doesn't start a storm for somebody who he is not threatened by. If you're going through a storm, there's something so big on the other side. You must be important because that big bad devil has been huffing and puffing, and he thought he would blow your house down. But he's trying to prove your foundation. Is your house on the solid rock? Christ Jesus. The devil has confused you so long. So you thought the storm meant that God had left you. But in this passage, the storm means he's on his way. If you're going through a storm right now, I want you to know that the storm is a sign that grace is on its way. Don't fear. The Bible says the storm came up suddenly. The moment Jesus started in the direction of the man, here comes the storm, not because God wasn't with him, but precisely because he was heading in his direction. So if that's true, if what I just said is true, that there is a storm that proves nobody attacks what is not valuable. Why would you guard someone who wasn't in a position to score? I know you're important. When I get to this man called Legion and say he was living among the tombs and cutting himself with stones, they would disassociate themselves and say, well, I got some problems, but I'm not. You may say, I've got some problems, but I'm not that bad. And when he says, my name is Legion, they'll back off him and disassociate with him and say, well, I'm like the disciples going through the storm, but I'm not the man called Legion. Really? Are you so sure? Because they said he lived among the tombs. So you don't go to dead places? Are you sure? Are you sure this isn't you somewhere in here? It may have a different demonstration, but it's the same dynamic. Because I said they would try to chain him up, and he would break the chains, and they couldn't hold him anymore, and he would hurt himself. Are you telling me there's no area of your life where you're not out of control? The more I studied it, I thought maybe there's some Legion in all of us. I don't mean demonic possession, but I do mean oppression. You have got your own chains. I'll tell you the greatest secret God ever showed me. I was learning this lesson watching millionaires who were miserable. And I realized the devil doesn't check your net worth or your money or your account before he tries to wreck your house. And I saw nice smelling people with country clubs, memberships, with country club memberships and stuff. They drove beautiful cars, the top of the range. They ate the best breakfast and yet freaking out on depression medication. I'm no longer intimidated to preach the Bible like it really is. Once I realize that you might be out of control in your spending, your eating, if I kept going long enough, I'd clear the whole list of self-righteousness. There would not be one more Pharisee spirit left to hear this sermon if I kept going on. I will name every demon that's oppressing you. Jesus knew the man was crazy when he got on the boat. It didn't stop him from coming. That got me excited. I figured maybe he knows about our issues too. I am legion, this man said. Legion is 6,000 foot soldiers. That's a lot of demons. Jesus said, what is your name? You know my name. Do you know yours? Do you know who you are? Or do you have so many different personas? There's an online you. There's a Sunday morning you. That's the only one that I ever get to see. Then I found out there's a Friday night you. There's a Facebook you. There's a you that only you know. There's a you that cries out day and night. You don't cut yourself with stones. I understand that. But sometimes you inflict yourself with pain and you can't stop it. And you don't even know why you keep pushing people away. You've been living among the tombs for so long. Somebody's tomb is the mall. Somebody's tomb is pornography. Somebody's tomb is an addiction that if we named it, you'd think surely that person couldn't come to church. You'd be surprised how quick the demons run to Jesus. These demons ran before Jesus and fell before him and said, don't make us leave. This man was important to Jesus. They knew that they were about to vacate the premises of this man's personality and his psychology. And they knew that someone strong enough to subdue them had finally showed up in the region of the Gadarenes. Maybe you have tried everything else and you've run to everyone else, but I declare today you were in the presence of a greater grace. And what works couldn't do, and the law couldn't do, and the chains couldn't do, and the shekels couldn't do, God's about to do it in your life. Grace can do what chains can't do. This morning, I know our time is up. There's so much more that I need to share with you. You need to listen next week. I'm going to show you what happened to the pigs. And that's very interesting. So I want you to tune on next week and listen to the balance of the sermon. But today, I want you to see yourself in the story. I want you to see what Jesus wouldn't do for you. And I want you to know he leave everything for one soul, for one hurting person, for one person that is right now going through trauma, for one person that is sick, for one person that is dying, for one person that cannot make it. He wants to meet you at the level of your faith. I told you this message is about faith versus fear? Is your fear stopping you from the faith that God is looking for? God looks at faith and He only works on faith. Faith moves the heart of God. Faith moves mountains. Faith will cause you to rise up from your sick bed. Faith will cause you to wake up and be a missionary. I'm going to show you what happened to Legion after he was healed. He became the first missionary. And I want you to know God will heal you for His glory. God will heal you to do His work. God will heal you. God will raise you up to do His bidding. That is the only reason God created you. For Him, not for anyone else. Not for you, but for Him. And God wants to heal you for Him. He wants to deliver you for Him. He wants to bring out those demons for Him so that He can be glorified. Remember when this man was crying in the tombs, God heard him. God heard him. And God is hearing you this morning. God hears your cry. He hears you when you pray. And I want to say nothing goes in vain. God has a plan and a purpose for you. And when your purpose is over, then only will your time be up. But until you have purpose, God will bring you through. You've got to cross the storm. God will cross the storm just to get to you. He'll cross every barrier to get to you. And I want you to have faith this morning that your healing is emotion, your problems will be solved, and God will come through for you. No matter what your situation, God will come through for you. I trust that this message has been a blessing to you. And until we meet next week, stay blessed. Let's bow for prayer. Father God, we thank you for your word. Your word is life and power. Lord, the more we study your word, we see, Lord. Father God, you will cross every storm and every barrier, Lord. You'll cross every river, Lord, and every sea to get to us, Lord. Father God, you cross the sea of, Lord, you cross the sea, Lord, of Galilee. For this one demonic man, dear Father God, you're a God that will cross any barrier, Lord, for your children, dear Master God. One soul is important to you, dear Master God. And I thank you, Lord, as your children bow before you this morning, Lord. Hear their prayer. Hear their cry. Answer them, dear Father God. Let their faith rise up, Lord. Father God, this morning we pray, dear Father God, fear will not grip us, Lord, because you have authority and power. And that same authority and power is given to us, Lord. In Genesis 1:26, you gave us power and authority. And we stand on your word, dear Father. We stand with authority this morning, Lord, that we can do the greater work. Father, we thank you for your word, Lord. May it find an abiding place in our hearts. May it take root and grow, Father God, that from this day forward, we will walk in faith and victory. Father God, that every barrier, Lord, will be broken. Every chain will be broken. Every fear will be gone. And we will live in victory. We thank you for your word. We thank you, Lord, that you are the resurrection and the life. Though we were dead, yet shall we live, dear Father God. We thank you that there's life in your word. There's life in our lives, dear Father God. And if we stand on your word, we can move mountains. We give you the glory, the praise, and the honor, Lord. Be it unto us according to your word. In Jesus' mighty name. Amen and amen. Beloved people of God, I trust that you will stand on God's word. As you believe it, He will come through for you.